All right, so welcome everybody to tonight's symposium on Salvatic architecture. My name is Bronwyn. I'm going to be your hostess. I am the one of the event organizers for the NWTAA, which, if you're wondering, is the Architects Association for the Northwest Territories. Tonight, we have a series of presentations by professional architects and engineers and a couple of other types, carpenters and builders. So they will be sharing, they're going to be sharing their ideas, their passionate thoughts, their years and years of experience, and we're going to have a question session at the end, so don't be shy for that. Please do ask your questions to the speakers. And I am going to announce the first speaker, Simon Taylor. Where is Simon? So Simon is the principal architect of Taylor Architecture Group. Tonight his topic is going to touch on local labor, which of course is highly important to everybody in this room. Now, some people consider the requirement to include local labor as a burden to the project. However, Simon is going to show that despite the increase in construction costs, the early local consultation of locals, particularly remote communities, is actually part of the economic solution. So his presentation is going to include the Kugaruk Hamlet and Community Hall Project, which are examples of how this process can work. His talk is called The Scale of Outside Inside. Come on up, Simon.
All right, so I'm not doing inside-outside scale, I'm sorry, but I started with that and I got more interested in this. We did a project recently, it's actually not yet finished, where we ended up using a lot of local labor to sort out the economic issue. It's in Kugaruk, which is a very remote community, only accessible by air, or actually the Coast Guard, the sea lift doesn't even make it into this community. And we took on a project that was a $9 million budget. This is, I'm all over the place, but this is a small piece of art, and one of the things that I'm interested in this community is their small scale art, and all of their art is small scale, very detailed, and I'll come back to this later in the involvement. But early in the project, we presented to the community our schematic design alternatives. And I was sitting at the presentation area, and this family was hovering around. And I said, so which is your favorite? And one of the guys said, well, which one's going to take longer to build? That's our favorite. And so that, in conjunction with the government saying, you know what, we need a different site here, we met with the community. We convinced the government to get interested in actually meeting with the public of Kugaruk and sort of finding out who is interested in being part of this build process. So Chris, who's actually here tonight, there he is, met with the locals. He got the information from them. He got information about what they get paid, their credentials, whether they hunt or not, if hunting is an issue, whether they would leave the construction site, all that sort of data. And we were able to get a list of over 50 people in the community that were interested, engaged in this possible project. And we included this document, this data, with the specifications, with all the contact information of each person, so that when this went out for tender, the contractors could actually contact these people, find them, and use them on the project. In addition to that, we went around, and that's also Chris, looking at the equipment that is available in the community, and we have provided that information as well in the specifications. Just again, trying to use what is local as part of that process. So this is an early plan, and when we were developing the plan, one of the key issues was what can actually come into the community. So the key, the biggest facility in there is the community hall, and the span of that was governed by a commercially viable and available trust that we could actually get into the community on the barge. So that was one of the key sort of drivers of the form and the proportions of the building. And then as we devolved the design, everything was wood frame. So there's steel piles into the ground, and then everything from the foundation frame up was wood framed. You'll see at the bottom left-hand corner, there's 3M. We've used Roxel insulation. The whole assembly system that we developed was designed so that the local people can be part of that building process, either with a foreman guiding them or doing it themselves. And this was taken on by the contractor who ended up being Kudlik. That's also Chris. I'm using Chris as fillers here. But yeah, this is a view of the roof. But we, the Kudlik, were able to hire the local people at around $30 to $50 a person, and they're not paying accommodation, they're not paying transport, they're not paying for in and out for every 3 weeks. And these people showed up day in, day out, and you know, originally we were looking at the Hamlet actually organizing the retaining and paying of people, but it worked out better, less cumbersome, that the contractor just did it straight up. And so everything is wood framed. The locals were involved in drywall. All that the contractor did with the main trades, bring up a foreman, they'd establish a crew from the community, and that crew would build pretty much everything, with the exception, obviously, of specialist trades like electrical controls, etc. The documents that we prepared were all prepared essentially as assembly diagrams, more so than sort of standard construction drawings. And again, even on the outside of the landscaping involvement, everything was wood, timber, so that the local population can get involved regardless of the skill level. And then another aspect that we brought into the project was, again, that local art. And we included a cash allowance for the contractor to hire a local artist to develop art for the interior hall and develop murals. And then the contractor had a set amount of money to pay and institute that. This is also Chris swimming up there. But this aspect of ensuring that the local involvement was key in almost all aspects of the project was readily accepted by the contractor, and as I'll explain later, worked out on their behalf. These are actually images from the left, images from Joe Haven, the right is from Cambridge Bay, the glass display cases. And again, when I come back to the art, the community art is not sort of large pieces. They're actually very small, very intricate pieces. And so in developing the interior and display spaces, we developed these small, well-lit little boxes to sort of focus your vision to look at these pieces. And that started to inform the interior design. And as I say, this building is not yet finished. So I can't show you spectacular rendered or finished imagery. It's in construction. We're wrapping it up now. But this is it. When we tendered this project, the budget was around $9 million. It came in at 7.9. The local labor, we targeted 40 to 45%. We ended up with 47% local labor. So it's achievable, and it works, and it's economical. And I think we were quite keen to see that that is a working process.
Thank you, Simon. Wow, it is better to hold this mic, actually. All right, where's Wayne Guy? There you are. Okay, Wayne Guy is, he is the founder of the NWTAA and the very first president of it. He's also a fellow of the Royal Architecture Institute of Canada, and he chaired the task force for implementing the 2030 challenge, which, for those of you that don't know, is the project whose objective is that all buildings in Canada will be carbon neutral by 2030, which is absolutely amazing. Wayne's presentation is going to include observations from his 30 years of architectural experience in the North. Coming up, Wayne.
Thank you, Bronwyn. So it's a real pleasure to have all of you here sharing within the community what we do up here. So my talk's called Form, Color, and Composition, an Architectural Lexicon for the Arctic. And basically, the Arctic is a very beautiful place. It has very strong landscapes, very strong cultures. And what to be an architect up here is really an honor and a privilege. And what we try to do is fit, we cannot compete with that marvelous landscape. So we try to make meaning out of the built form in a way that makes sense for the people who inhabit it. So light, symbol, and culture. We use our detailing to express a host of things. So some people say it looks like a nookshux, others say it looks like columns and crosses. Also, if you look at the juxtaposition of color, this beautiful rock, there's history here, so both the old and the new are juxtaposed, but we wanted to make it sympathetic, and in doing so, composition became very important. This is a project we did for Sir John Franklin High School, Craftsmanship, Icon, and Aspiration. We actually, because these were young people wanting to be estheticians, we wanted to inspire them in an environment that would really make them go out into the world and excel. Sign, symbol, and process. This is the motor vehicle. Some of you may recognize it. We actually used symbols used in cars for traffic direction as key elements to move a lot of people through a tiny space in a very short period of time, focusing on detailing. Place, memory, and identity. A lot of these communities have such strong presence, and this was a project we did in Hay River Reserve, where we actually looked at what was important to the community. And in this building here, we have a canoe that was part of the interior design that was stuck into the ceiling. We did this project with Baird Sampson Newart. It's Habitation, Ecology, and Economy. Community gardens. This is a net zero building, does not burn a single drop of carbon during its process, during its annual run. And also, because the landscape's such a strong element, the allegorical landscape, this is a project we did for Yellowknife Catholic Schools, and we actually detailed it like a landscape, the hedge, the congregation area for staff. We used seats and that looked like hedges. Creating identity and well-being. This is a project we did for the Guild of Arts and Craft, and we used sort of iconic windows to, you know, try to express the creativity that happens in that wonderful building. And also siding, you never have to touch it for 50 years. We love using metal. Work, live, and thrive. You know, we spend 40 to 60 hours a week, depending on where you work. And we think work environment should be exemplary. And this is we renovated the YK Center four floors, and we used color and light and translucency to bring light right into the core. This is our architect's office. This is our inspiration, creativity, and adaption. It used to be an old, dark mechanics shop. And what we did, we brought tons of light in through a southwest door and used simple elements to hide stairs and as a composition. One of my favorite buildings, the Fort Good Hope office, when eagles perch, that's what the elders said. They love these little elements. We developed this back in 2000. And what happened is it looks like an eagle perching and the community. Now, being Arctic sensibility, these are projects we did internationally, the Geneva project, and also a tower that replenishes the aquifer of the Sahara by using a vertical sort of solar chimney, a vertical garden, and then precipitates out salt to build your new environment with salt. Culture and place, you may recognize this as the drum. It's the band the Wrigley Band Office, and these lights are patterned after the drum dance and the drum. So I hope I'm doing it right, but the idea being that we can use movement and allegory in our architecture. The Midnight Sun Rec Complex, Arctic Oasis, you think you're in the tropics, but we use very strong forms and animated environment to really generate a wonderful, delightful space. This is the new Kivalliq Regional Visitor Center. We're just finishing in Rankin Inlet. There are 7 communities in the Kivalliq. These 7 booths are symbolic of each of the communities and art displays for each of the communities. Lovely light and really an area for the community to get together. Now, immensity and intimate, it's a very important. This was the old medical center, the Great Slave Medical. We developed this lighting system and wall assembly. So even though it's a very narrow building, it still had that sense of openness to it. So we managed to really stretch the program that way. Abode, form of living. This is working with the landscape. We try to use the palette of the landscape, but very strong counterpoints on the forms. And this is a multifamily project that we did last couple of years. But this is a project, we were shortlisted for the Canadian High Research Station, High Arctic Research Station with Moriyama Tashima. We developed this glazing here, it's R20 glazing, so we can have most of the facade open. And it was sort of inspired by the stone rings of Nunavut. So thank you so much for this lovely opportunity. We find color, form, and architecture up here a very pleasant place to work. And if it's people like you and the communities and cultures that we meet that make architecture really a fun thing for us. Thanks so much.
Thanks, Wayne. All right, the Inuvik Tutuktoyaktuk Highway is the first of a series of new transport corridor investments by the federal government. So these corridors are going to spur investments in potential resource projects, and collectively, these investments are going to spin off into greater infrastructure needs in the north, which kind of serves the market which many of us work in our day-to-day jobs. Warren McLeod is the project manager, or was the project manager, for the Inuvik Tutuktoyaktuk Highway. He is one of the people that brought this dream into a reality, and now he's going to present on it.
All right, so my job today is to distill just under 6 years of experience in just over 6.5 minutes. it's just a general overview of the Inuvik Tutuktoyaktuk Highway. And I tell you a joke, but I don't have enough time. So this project dates back to the 60s when it first came up in discussions between the federal and territorial governments. In the 70s, there was some preliminary work and investigations and design for the alignment. Then the project pretty much went dormant for about 40 years, and it regained momentum in around 2010. When completed in November 15th, it'll be about 140 kilometers long. It'll be an all-season road. It'll eliminate the need for the seasonal ice road, and it'll provide greater access to the outside world for community members, and it'll also open up the region for industry and tourists alike. The biggest number here is the 5 million cubic meters of embankment that was needed to be sourced and placed. To put that into context for you, picture a pathway that's about a meter wide by a meter high, stretching from Vancouver to just outside of Montreal. The general basis behind the design, and I'm really simplifying this, so Ed Hove, don't jump on me, is to keep the underlying ground frozen And so the minimum depth of embankment is just under 2 meters. And we also allowed for a seasonal settlement of 0.4 because this was all built in winter and in frozen conditions. So we had to find all that 5 million cubes, and we did it over three winter drilling programs. So a total of 24 borehole sources were looked at, about 700 boreholes drilled, all in over 3 years, but only in with 1 month for each year to do it. So once we found the sources, this is typically how they were developed. A drill would come in, drill and blast the material. Then the bulldozers and excavators would come along and fill up the rock trucks, and then they would head out to the highway. So the snowcats would come along, and they push the snow out of the way, and then the crews would come along and lay out some geotextile there, and then the rock trucks would come along and haul the material. So you can see this truly it was built in winter conditions. A very non-typical way of building highways. So this is further along. As the embankment got closer and closer to its design height, the rock trucks would come along. I don't know if the person on the quad there is a local, just keeping an eye on things, but and some of these 20 seconds is a long time or a short time. So in the summer, things would shut down as breakup happened. As some seasonal melt happened, the graders would then come in, scarify the surface, blade it out, and the packers would come along and get the compactive effort into it. And then at each winter season, there was three total. This is what the finished product looked like. There's still some fine gravel surfacing to go on this. So this was in probably early autumn at the start of one of the winter seasons. So to keep the core frozen, you had to place the culverts in cool temperatures. So what the bottom left picture kind of jarred my memory, because sometimes people thought we were crazy putting a culvert where you couldn't tell if this thing was going to drain or not when summer came along. Bridges had a full year cycle, mainly driven by the ad-freeze pile foundations. So we'd go in the winter, drill and put in the ad-freeze piles. They would sit for a year. That's not a community art installation project. That's actually the foundations waiting for the next year. So precast concrete girders were selected, mainly because we wanted to have something that could be transported to site relatively easily and also be put up relatively quickly in the cold climate that these things were installed in. There's a few pictures of the bridges because I kind of like them. But I also remember just what a challenge it was to design all eight of these in about a year. So this is a finished product. There's still a little bit of work to be done on the embankment approaches. This next slide, you'll kind of see again a bit more what I was talking about. So if you look at this, there isn't a very well-defined channel, which you normally see. So again, you know, after we put one of these things in the next summer, everything melted, and people saw this, they were kind of wondering if maybe we put these things in the wrong place or not. Very scenic pictures of these culverts, but again, these kind of bring back some nightmares because there was a lot of talk about culverts and how they were going to affect the performance of the road. Not only that, but there was concerns about how they would affect fisheries passage after they were built. These are some typical landforms. The bottom left is one of the borehole sources after development. Those tiny specks there are those giant rock trucks. The top right is the most sensitive terrain that the highway went over, called it was termed polygonal terrain. there was a lot of lessons learned and still being learned about this project, but for me, from the start of my involvement with it, is I learned the importance of collaboration early on, not just with regulatory agencies and stakeholders, but clients. And it's important to build that sense of trust with the people you're working with, because when things go wrong, as they inevitably will, you need to have a good relationship with them. So I thought it was fitting to end this presentation with a picture of the end of the road. I'm going to be going up to Inuvik November 15th and hopefully getting a selfie with Justin Trudeau. And just seeing if, in fact, like I've heard the locals call it the road to happy. I've been on the job for 6 years and I haven't seen the highway yet, so I'm kind of excited to go see it.
Wow, so cool. Thank you. All right, our next presenter is Kehan Naji, who I'm pretty sure that anybody that's been in Niven cannot possibly miss his beautiful circular house with the bold teepee roof that is his award-winning personal home. So Kehan is the principal architect of Naji Architects. And tonight, his topic is teepee house design concepts and definition of some relevant architectural terms. Come on up, Kehan.
Okay. Thank you. So, so this is the title of the project, obviously. you know that. And what I'm trying to achieve, use some terms that's used in Northern architecture, and we take those terms into my design. The word architect is derived from arctos, Greek word for bear, in the northern sky. Two constellations called Ursa Major and Ursa Minor, the Great Bear and the Little Bear, circle endlessly around one fixed point in the heavens, Polaris. sub-arctic, obviously the term sub-arctic that we are focusing today is being region immediately south of Arctic Circle that the project that I'm going to talk about it is part of that. That's this is my design for my house. This conceptual design is based on teepee architecture. And my objective in designing this project was understanding the characteristic of the vernacular architecture in relation to changing environment. The design also reflects an increasing awareness of the way architecture affects and is affected by environment as well as culture. So we are going to see next slide. It takes more than 20 minutes at this time. The location of the house that's decided when we bought the land is affords one of the best view in the city overlooking the river and bays. To maximize this advantage, there are many windows and two levels of walkout decks, the environmentally sensitive site. Now, the term that I use from indigenous architecture, like teepee and conical, in this project, I'm going to talk about what those terms means and why I use it in this project. So teepee, you know, the Sioux for teepee means used to live in. As a prehistoric house form, the teepee has been returned and integrated with modern forms. Teepees have been returned for ideological and psychological reasons during the time. And also conical shelters have no doubt been used for hundreds of thousands of years. In fact, within the history, we find people living in conical skin tents around the Arctic Circle. So these are the terms that you can see this is used in my own design. That is the partial of the roof of the house, which is all glass, and the partial view of the conical roof of the house that brings all the lights from outside to the staircase. The other thing that's very important in the indigenous culture to have fire in the center. We try to adopt that one within the house. So as you see, the stove is sitting in the center of the house. And that is coming again from the dinner culture, which they always kept fire going in the center of the teepee. So that is that's another aspect of the of the architecture that they use. And you see here the center of the house, the fireplace, the wood stove there in the center. And also from there, you can see that there's a rotunda entering hall with fire stove right in the center. The other things that conical issues that I talked to, this, it has a 10 feet skylight with the penetration of chimney from the stove into the skylight. This was all calculated, designed by a computer. So the other aspect of it, with the generous use of glass in the skylight, allowing a sense of openness during the daylight into the stairwell, and observing northern lights at night, which gives another aspect of the project. The form of the house is circle. Why the circle is important? Because circle, Aboriginal people felt a kinship with the natural world. They believe that everything in life relates to circle. Everything the power of the world does is in circle. So this is circular plan, which is the basic concept of enclosed spaces. So these are the circular shape of the house that stops from the top and comes to the second floor. You see, we use this shape. It's most efficient for enclosing the volume, as we see in indigenous architecture. The same thing, this minimizes the use of materials and presents the least possible surface for heat gain and loss. The circular plan directs the earth's forces naturally around the building. A few corners reduce wind turbulences to a minimum. it encloses the given area with a shorter overall length of walls, and energy consumption is dramatically reduced because of the form of the building. from the stove inside the house, you can see we circulate the air into the house. So this teepee house won one of the 2000 National Post-Design Exchange Award in Architecture, and the Design Exchange magazine recognized the architects for the design of unique northern housing in Yellowknife under the term of innovative Canadian design. Juries recognized this house as bring unity between two cultures, Dene and Inuit. And thank you.
Thank you. All right. So, heating. It is one of the major energy costs in a building's life cycle. And tonight, Brian George is going to talk about efficient mechanical design and why the Arctic mechanical systems are different. Brian has worked on projects in every single community in the NWT and Nunavut, which is absolutely amazing. Why don't you come here and tell us about mechanical design?
Thank you. You've been here long enough, you can usually work in all the communities. It'll get there. So it's really the climate that starts off and why we design things different. And the climate, a summer climate in Edmonton and Yellowknife is almost the same, but in Resolute it's getting quite cool. In the winter climates, again, Edmonton is still in the same range as Yellowknife, and Resolute's very close to Yellowknife. But the average temperatures in Edmonton are well above zero, where the average temperatures in Yellowknife are below zero, and in Resolute they're way below zero. That creates lots of problems in permafrost, and snow drifting in Resolute is just crazy. Here's a 10-foot high oil tank that you can walk right up to. Transportation, of course, is strange all through the territories. One barge a season, snow road, or winter ice roads, or all season highways all affect the design solutions that we choose. Can't remember what's next. Ah, yes. Cost of electricity. In Alberta, it's about 40-some cents a gigajoule for electricity. In Yellowknife, it's about 60 cents a gigajoule. And in many parts of the territories, it's over $200 a gigajoule. For oil, for natural gas, in Alberta, it's $3 to $5 a gigajoule. Oil in Yellowknife is about 28 and rises up to about $60 a gigajoule. Propane is about the same price as oil, and wood pellets is quite a bit cheaper. Our construction costs are about 190 to 260% the cost of construction down south. The maintenance costs track this. They may be even higher. Electricity costs anywhere from 50 to 400% higher, and fuel costs anywhere from 900% higher. So solutions the architect comes up with, they stack the building up off the ground. This creates permafrost under the building, and then we got to squeeze the mechanical system in between that because the architect doesn't want to go any higher. The other solution, of course, is to put thermosiphons in. The thermosiphons lower the building down, and now we have to squeeze under that to put all our mechanical systems in. The 20 seconds does take a long time. Oh yes, the utilidors, all the way, always down south, similar in Yellowknife, you've got good water and sewer coming to your house. Here we've got good water and sewer buried in a lot of the communities, but it's all an insulated pipe with very expensive transitions. Or above ground, we run it all above ground, raising the building back up. And we start emphasizing design as being a heating design. So we have to use propylene glycol in all our systems to make sure they don't freeze. Plumbing vents coming up through the roof, we've got to insulate and heat trace. And then we add a little bit of ornamentation to the buildings with snow hoods and solar walls, and I think these should be accented in your architectural systems. All our connections to the buildings, and we end up having quite a few, need to have flexible connections because the ground outside the building moves and the building tends to stay solid and the same. And these are the areas under the building that the architect squeezes out of us. The maintainers have to go down through these places and maintain these systems. And the architect seldom comes down here to inspect. I've never seen it happen yet. Of course, most of the places don't have water and sewage connections, so we have to provide water and sewage tanks inside the building. These take up lots of space, and some of the tanks get tremendously big, especially when we have sprinkler systems to support. And then we've got our fuel tanks outside. Propane where available, with clearances around them that just occupy your site. And mechanical engineer usually wants to fit these on the front of the building where it's most apparent and the fuel truck can get to it. And then pellet boilers. Nice, beautiful silo to accent your building. Doesn't always have to be a silo. This is the one at the airport on the right there with the silos built right into the building. And we didn't have an architect involved in this project. Where we have gas available, we do put in condensing gas boilers. Now we have to vent these out through the side, and then we get these ornamentations that fit on your buildings. So we have to be cognizant of that. And the controls. Controls have typically been very simple systems. We put in idiot lights on the outside of the building, coming in freezing, or, but it's moving more and more to DDC systems. It's just not, the communication systems up in the north have not been keeping up yet. But I think one of the buildings, a big modern building like the Greenstone Building, or a little building up in Tuktoyaktuk, the airport, it really turns out the mechanical systems are not that different than we do down south. It becomes the details that are different, and details make all the difference. Thank you.
Oh, those mechanical systems. Too bad they're so unattractive. Okay, anyway, good northern building practices are something important and interesting to anybody that is building in the north. Our next speaker is Randy Jacobs. He is currently the Senior Architectural Technical Officer for the GNWT Department of Infrastructure, and he is a journeyman carpenter. Now, Randy has built 5 of his own houses, and when I asked him today how many houses has he built for other people, it's so many that he couldn't even remember how many. So it's lots, extensive. He is going to present the basics of practical northern building architecture.
Thanks, Barbara.
Hey, thanks. Thanks for coming out, everybody. I just have a little bit of a mishmash of a little bit of everything. I tried to do something a little bit more extensive, but I found out that there just wasn't enough time, so we'll just get things going. We typically specify the persist wall system in our buildings. The system was originally developed by the National Research Council of Canada. The principle of the system is to move the environmental barriers from in the wall assembly to the exterior of the wall assembly. This keeps the wall structure inside the insulated or assembly and out of the weather and temperature changes. The advantages of the system is you get a continuous air, thermal, and vapor barriers that reduces thermal bridging and keeps water shedding membrane away from the structure. The disadvantages are it is more expensive and requires skilled tradespersons that may not be available in the communities. The first component to get installed is the air vapor barrier, and that's usually applied over the wall sheeting. There's a primer that goes on the wall sheeting, and then the air vapor gets installed on top of that, and then the roller is used to basically fully adhere the membrane to the substrate. Next, we'd put on a thermal barrier. Doing it this way also allows us to put as much insulation on there as we want, rather than if you have a wall cavity, you're limited by space. With this type of system, that works a little better. Next is the rain screen system. This consists of a primary drainage plane, which would be the cladding. Our secondary drainage plane would be basically a breathable membrane that's right on top of the insulation and an airspace. The airspace serves a couple, the airspace is the pressure equalized with what they use in the acronym. The intent is that you have the same pressure behind the cladding as you do at the exterior, and you don't have negative pressures that's gonna draw moisture into the wall system. It also is a capillary break, so if you do have moisture coming in through the cladding, that it can drain out to the bottom. These are two types of commonly used insulations. The one on the right there is extruded polystyrene, and extruded polystyrene, and the one on the left is polyisocyanurate. They both are closed cell insulation systems, and they have very high R value rates for their thickness. This is fast becoming a very popular insulation with us as well, too, specifically because it's a non-combustible insulation. When you're dealing with a community, a remote community where you don't have the firefighting capabilities are not as substantial as what you'd have, like say in Yellowknife, and they may not be capable of fighting a fire in a larger structure. So anything we can do to reduce the combustible content is a good thing. Expanded polystyrene is not something that we typically use. It has voids in it that if it does get wet, it can take on the moisture. There's another thing about polystyrene as well too, or expanded polystyrene, I should say, that it sometimes doesn't necessarily react well with VOCs or some of the peel and stick membranes. Here's four common window frames that we typically, or that are typically used in the north. They all each have their advantages and disadvantages. vinyl window frames are your least expensive option. They're, like I say, the lowest cost, but they're also probably the weakest frame out of all the other four that are up there too. They typically use in a smaller wood frame structure where you want to keep your cost down and the performance is not as quite as critical. Wood frame windows are generally more used for aesthetics, for architectural reasons. They don't have the same kind of, there's a little bit of maintenance that goes along with these, so you have to make sure keep them stained and oiled or that type of thing. But this is our go-to frame. Fiberglass frames are definitely for us sort of the best bang for our buck because fiberglass is roughly 8 times stronger than vinyl. The cost of the window is probably roughly 1.5 times of that of vinyl. And it has the same thermal expansions and contraction rate as the glazing itself, so you don't have a lot of movement between the frame and the sealed unit. Thermally broken aluminum frame windows are more for larger commercial projects where you want a substantial, durable window that's going to last roughly the lifespan of the building, basically. This standard was introduced in the 2010 National Building Code, so it's everybody should be on board with this one. This kind of sort of replaces the old CSA A440, which used to be the standard that windows were required to be constructed for buildings. The first thing is under this standard is windows are required to be labeled for performance class. They have four performance class ratings: residential, light construction, light commercial, I'll say, low-rise and mid-rise buildings, and architectural windows. And each one of those window classes basically goes up in value as far as the performance grade is basically a measurement of the design pressure that the building's been built to, the water resistance rating, air infiltration, exfiltration rating. And this is typically what you'll see on a label for under the new NAF standard. You'll have the performance class, the performance grade, the size of the window, the design pressure that it's been tested to, and the water resistance that it's been tested to, and the air infiltration, exfiltration. This is a screenshot of a calculator that's on the Fenestration Canada's website. It's a great little tool if you want to, because now with NAVs, everything is location specific. Much like snow loading, we don't have the same snow loading in Yellowknife as what you'd have in Ulahuktuk. Same thing, you won't have the same requirements for your window pressure testing in Yellowknife as what you would have in Ulahuktuk. Actually, RDH Engineering has a lot of great articles about NAVs if you want to read up on that a little bit more. So they explain it a lot better than I do. Yeah. Okay.
Thanks, Randy. So, speaking on off-grid living in subarctic climates is Wade Carpenter, who knows all about this topic because he's been building off-grid homes and living in them for over a decade. Now, off-grid living may mean that you can bend all sorts of code rules and basically ignore all of the silly ones. Which this is a topic that is interesting for independent thinkers, libertarians, and those who want to live a less simple life. Wade Carpenter is going to present on off-grid living.
Thank you. And GNWT Infrastructure is definitely not sponsoring this, although I do work for them. That's my off-grid hopes. Show of hands, who's lived off-grid or is currently living off-grid, including shacks? Hands up. Look around. Everybody look around. That's at least 30 people, 25 to 20. Built this house in 2007. What defines off-grid? Well, in Yellowknife, there's sort of three levels. You know, there's the electrical grid, there's the water and waste grid, and I guess the heating grid is sort of how I define it. Shacks in Yellowknife generally have electricity and only partially water maybe in the summer, but in the winter they're responsible mostly for their own water. Off the Ingram Trail, somebody said to me about 300 off-grid homes up there. It's not for the intrepid living off-grid. You have to prepare. You can't depend on really anybody else for what you do. And I find that people in the north who come here are sort of suited for this type of lifestyle. And finally, off-grid on the water and ice is where I chose to off-grid by renting a place in 1998, I guess, is when I first started. And it has some other challenges because it is on the water, and we'll get to that and talk about my personal experience with it. This design build, or sometimes you're building and designing as you go along, for those of you who've done this before. And this one was definitely a huge renovation from some old hunting shacks, and eventually got to the product that I wanted with extra insulation, different float sets, different roofs, everything. You know, no matter how much of a hippie you are, everybody likes electricity. And to get that, solar power in the north is actually very good. Off six solar panels on this houseboat, I'm able to not run my generator below there for eight months of the year. That was my record. Wind power is also another way to get electricity. This is the most popular wind turbine, small wind turbine in the north. It's a 200-watt system. There's a couple on the bay. There's a couple up the Ingram Trail. And generally they go zzz, 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 and the neighbors don't like them too much, so you don't see a lot of them around. They have to be put on high posts. Batteries, did I spell batteries right? Yeah, okay, good. Everybody's talking about Tesla and these new lithium-ion batteries. Currently, the best bang for your buck, unfortunately, still is flooded lead-acid batteries. It is important, although I don't abide by all codes, lead-acid batteries do make hydrogen gas, so I do vent them through a battery box. Living off-grid, everybody knows this. I'm probably talking to a lot of people who've lived off-grid longer than I have. Fran in the front row there has been doing it quite long time. And efficiency and conservation, if you choose to have TVs or lighting, they better be LED. And you can't afford to have an electric stove because generally the solar PV system cannot handle electric element heating or of any kind. AC/DC, I like to use DC because there's lots of from the RV industry, and if you're working with an inverter, which does go to 110, that has a phantom draw of about 20 watts, and if you leave it on 24/7, it sure drains your battery, so use DC if you can. Wood heat. I like the catalytic stoves. That's a catalytic platinum converter. It does a double burn, so the exhaust coming out of your chimney is relatively clean, and you can get like a 12-hour burn out of a good wood stove. Off-grid people, very familiar with the top propane 100-pounders for all those things that you have to haul around for your propane needs. Radiant propane heat when your wood fire dies. Of course, I said propane stove for cooking because you can't use electric elements. And finally, if you do water heating, it's an on-demand. Water. Well, people in the Bay, from my experience, all the folks I've known, we all drink the water from the Bay. We do usually a filter system, although I've known friends on the houseboats who've been drinking the lake water unfiltered for over 30 years, and they haven't mutated yet. I drill a hole through the ice and pump it up. Honey buckets, everybody's favorite. Of course, honey bucket, for southerners here, it's basically a bucket you shit in. And for northerners, you know what it is. We didn't get, gray water, I get rid of my gray water in those two, or to my two buckets, and I've been hauling those for over 10 years to the island to dump it in a gray water pit. And it's something you have to do. But the world's best off-grid toilet finally came. You guys know it. It's the Separate. And it separates the liquids and the solids, and it can be compostable. My neighbor's compost, and we're almost all on compost toilets now. Living on the edge, so you can't get a mortgage for most off-grid tiny houses, so you have to fund them yourselves. You can get insurance for a houseboat, but it's about $10,000 a year, so nobody does it. So when you're doing it, you're basically on your own. Hopefully it doesn't burn down. Environmental factors, so we got a lot of things there. Sometimes sharks come after with bears at the same time. Sometimes you might be featured on a cheesy reality show. Hopefully that doesn't happen again. And then, you know, you're crossing the lake with your dog periodically. And hazards, well, you know, this is right behind Jolliffe Island. We had a truck go through. There are currents around the bay that you have to have local knowledge of. You have to, you know, especially when you're putting in a houseboat, you have to watch out for waves, ice, and that's featured here in these slides. Sometimes houseboats get pushed around. They need to re-anchor after the ice comes in and out. Oh yeah, location, location, location. You can see on the right-hand side of this image, there's really no houseboats to the right. I guess that would be the east of Jolliffe Island, because those dog islands protect from ice flows, which are the most damaging to houseboats in Canada's last unregulated, or I should say self-regulating houseboat community. And it can be a good life, and this is probably the best time to enjoy it in the summer. But it is not for the faint at heart. People say, you don't pay tax out there, and I say, well, you pay elbow tax and back tax. It's something you just can't come home and crash on the couch. Thank you.
All right. So, many people in this room and in our community identify as being Indigenous, and that identity is something that should be accommodated in today's contemporary architecture. Our next speaker, Chris Clark, is a member of the Letsike Dene First Nations, and he's going to present, and he's LEED certified. And he's going to present his collaborative thesis on the design of the NWT Métis Nation Legislative Assembly Building in Fort Smith. Wow, that's quite a mouthful, Chris. just a warning that Chris somehow snuck out of sticking to the 20 by 20 presentation style drawing point at me. And I don't know how he got away with that, so here he is.
How I got away with that was that I just sent Bronwyn 20 slides. I didn't realize that it had to be 20 seconds per slide. That's one thing she didn't let me know. But, so my thesis project about 11 years ago for my master's in architecture project was called Cultural Paths, the Design of the Building for the Northwest Territory Métis Nation Legislative Assembly, which was a collaborative thesis between me and Matthew P.J. Hickey, who's also another Aboriginal architect in Canada. So me and him are the 11th and 12th Indigenous architects in Canada. So there's 13 Indigenous architects in Canada right now. So we want to look at the various different aspects of Métis and Indigenous culture into the design of contemporary buildings for Indigenous cultures. And we looked at various artifacts of Indigenous cultures, such as drums and fiddles to make music, clothes, and various other things, which we'll see soon. This is actually a Chipewyan suit there, which was made out of caribou hair, and some other Indigenous clothing, which was basically a display of the culture of Indigenous people where we used beading. Anyways, so moving on, the project was in Fort Smith, Northwest Territories, and it's at the 60th parallel of the world, basically. And so if we look at the following maps, we'll see that within the community of Fort Smith, we have a site there that was given to the Northwest Territory Métis Nation back about 15 or 20 years ago, and is the former site of the residential school. So one of the big things for this building was about turning that negative place of the residential school into a positive place that helps support the Métis people and the other indigenous people in the area. So we did a lot of mapping and to see where the paths were. There's a lot of just paths that were random within the community. Also then we looked at some cultural objects which we call deconceptualizations of the sled, clothing, the snare, landforms, and the drum. And those are to influence the overall design of the building. We want to look at atypical things to influence the design of the building, clothing, the snare with the 13 sticks, the aspect to the netherworld, the landforms, which was integral in Aboriginal culture. So there's the snare, which was said to be the, qualitative, this is a lot. So then we made these qualitative constructions, which were about place and about the path and a journey of nomadic peoples within the North, or any all of North America, really, for indigenous cultures. We looked at various things that would affect the building, such as sun angles and winds, predominant and sun angles. And then we looked at the circulatory model, which we took from that path, which influenced the building design in terms of having a sloped floor system, which was 1:19 everywhere in the building. And then we looked at taking that program and inserting it within the earth. So lifting the earth and taking it up. So you can look at the drawing here. This is a drawing of the top of the building, and you can't really see the building. And then you look inside, and there's all the different things that they wish to have. There's a museum, elder space. Above, there's the legislative assembly space, which is above the elder space, which is about our connection with the elders and having them influence that. And then all the offices that require for the government of the Northwest Territory Métis Nation. And then below, the drumming and fiddling circle for dance. So as you can see, the building grows from a landform, from the street, from zero elevation up through the building. And from the street, it actually looks like just a rock and a hill. And then you can see there's a spiritual place in the middle. And then again, this space here, which is the other space, and on top, the legislative assembly. And of course, you can see here the 1:19 sloped floors that go throughout the building, which are to increase communications within the nation. And then we have the exterior, which is using different metals and woods. Then some sustainable strategies, which, because as an indigenous person, we're very connected to the land and to nature, natural ventilation, natural lighting. And then we could see the pod system to actually inhabit the floor that's sloping. So these would be different desks and whatnot to inhabit the offices of the building. So this is just pictures of the model that we built, which was took us about 400 hours to make. So it's all out of acrylic. And then you can see in the middle the first spiritual space, and then up here is the area of the legislative assembly, which phenomenologically is indicative of a teepee, but in how that spiritually and sort of ephemerally wraps around you while also hovering above you. So if you've ever been in a teepee, you know how that feeling is, and it's very different than a square or a circle. Just various pictures of the model that was built. And for this building, or for this design, we won the Alberta Association of Architects Gold Medal for the best thesis. And the different materialities, so there's copper in the middle of the band, which was for the copper Indians, they called us, or the Yellowknife, which I am one. And then atop the ground, you can see here, this would be a view from the road where you can inhabit the area on top and also making area on top for birds and other animals to inhabit to propagate that sustainability with nature. In the front facade, there's an area with south glazing, which would be having all a living machine, which is basically a series of water, which goes from black water, so toilet water, and then uses different animals and plants to, and so you can see again, this is from the street. So it's a block here of granite, and then above, the landform, thank you.
Wow, thank you, Chris. I had no idea that there were so few Indigenous architects in Canada. That's crazy, we need more. Okay, let me get on to our last speaker, Avalanche Kid. Yeah. All right, so a castle of snow is something that not only Elsa, the Disney princess, can boast about. Avalanche Kid is going to be presenting on building the Snow King's snow castle tonight as and its intrinsic motivations. Avalanche Kid is an eight-year veteran working with snow and ice at the Snow King's Winter Festival. Last year, he was the lead builder and designed many of the parts of the castle. His talk is going to share some of the learned techniques, special materials, and grassroots organization. Come on up.
I'm the only one that brought a laptop. I did some writing. Actually, have some vacation time, so I did some creative writing, and this is it. If you grew up in Canada, you probably have fond memories of building in the snow as a kid. That's me in the middle at age 13. Check out our cool neon snowsuits. Check out the 6-foot snowbanks behind us. My hometown of Moncton was on a snowbelt, and I loved it. We'd burrow beds and slides and little hangout nooks forever. It encouraged playing with a capital P. A desire to seek out new things and challenges driven not by goals, but by enjoyment in the task itself. That intrinsic motivation, I'll say that again, intrinsic motivation is the spirit behind the Snow King's Winter Festival today, as it was 23 years ago when Anthony Folio built an elaborate snow fort for his kids and then called himself the Snow King. The Beatles are on risers and sitting on snow blocks. Wafers are in place, the wires are run. Window ice is set, the four walls are buttoned up, spiked and lagged, the tractor driver's got a big pile and is chomping at the bit. This is just part of our daily work schedule. It's important to harvest the snow by breaking up all the particles, then blowing them into the form to let them reconnect. The result is a uniform bond, not that unlike concrete, although it has its downfalls, i.e. melting. Snow is a free, clean, and abundant building material. Being in the pour is a bit like being in an avalanche. The rumbling and the vibrations, while you try not to get buried. Your job is simple. You stomp the snow to eliminate air pockets. Just don't lose your boot like Marty One Boot did. And don't look into the blow or you might end up with a frozen dog shit in your teeth. Previous castle designs could have been described as a draft worksheet with as-built sketches pasted over top. Although this process could have been seen as inefficient, it does create opportunity for valuable discoveries to happen. Like this one. On poor day, we decided to reduce the snow load on the backstage office, resulting in a different roof line between it and the hallway. And then someone suggested a window would let more light in the backstage and would look nice up there. And it did. This is a lift for snow and ice blocks with hand-painted decals and all. The Snow King and crew have always built or modified tools in order to make a job possible. This is evidence of a keen resourcefulness, self-determination, and passion for the work we are creating. When Joe Snow built the arch forms for Castle 19, it was a game changer. A modular set of three arches measuring 16 feet in length and can spread up to 10 feet wide. Once the pour is set, the forms simply fold inward and slide out. We call them the Beatles because of their shape. People ask me, aren't you sad that the castle, all your work just melts away? No, I say, our world is impermanent and the snow castle is a perfect symbol of that. Plus we get to do it all over again next year. Learn to cut straight lines. We want 25 grade A blocks per quarry. Brush the edges clean, keep your work area tidy, use a cart to haul them into storage. Stand them up straight. Take your time. Find your zen. The building must accommodate rock concerts, raves, fiddle dances, stage plays, puppet theater, community dinners, film festivals, architecture, cafe, fashion shows, cabaret, big stars, barbecue fundraisers, art shows, lectures, craft fairs, fresh air, sugar shacks, spoken word, playgrounds, hockey, comedy nights, tourist central, kids camps, and belly dancing. Since being a part of the design team, I've set my goals on serving the community in two new ways. One, an awesome playground to get the kids outdoors, and two, food and seating in the sun for parents within sight of their kids. This is a slide I designed and worked on, a dual racer that goes under a bridge and then splits with hard curves in opposite directions. Successfully building a safe embankment for the slide's curve was the biggest challenge. We harvest ice in the fall from Great Slave Lake when the ice surface is of a desired thickness. If the snow doesn't fall on it as it freezes, the constant agitation of the water below makes the ice crystal clear. Within the ice carving industry, panels like this sell for around $200. Once we discovered how to fit ice panels together using a handheld demolition saw and a nail board, we were laughing. Snowmobile and I created this 47-panel herringbone pattern window measuring 10 by 16 feet for Castle 20. For the past 4 or 5 years, after each season, we've held a charity auction beard shaving event. Afterwards, Snow King collects some of the beard hair and saves it in a baggie so that next season he can put it in the castle wall directly above the front door. Over the years, we've witnessed a lot of evidence that demonstrates a reliable strength in our snow structures. We've had a snow arch hold a static load of nearly 4 tons for weeks with no signs of failing. And it's worth mentioning that people paddled under their canoe under that one in late May. In 2017 alone, this grassroots festival saw nearly 13,000 people through its door. It put out $120,000 in wages. It received 1,744 hours volunteer time. It's a huge economic generator, benefit to the community, and it even had a visit from that guy. Thank you. Thank you. It was really a pleasure.
You might like a break. So, why don't you take a break? Think of what questions you may have for the speakers, and yeah, come back with your question. If you have a question, please raise your hand, and Alina here will bring the mic to you, and I'll take the mic to the speaker that you're questioning. So, who's got questions? Okay.
Hello, folks. I really appreciate the wonderful presentations that the NWTAA has provided tonight, and I think it is a credit to the community of specialists that have presented their work tonight. In 2001, a gang of government guys and some private sector guys got together and lobbied the government to move the NWT Architectural Society into the position of a professional association, and it was successfully done. I have a specific question about community involvement, and one of the presentations was so replete in mentioning community engagement and community sourcing. Right away, it occurred to me to ask a question. What about the kids in the community? How were they represented in the research work? How do they participate in the program of awareness? Because as well as being an architectural association for professional guidance and development, this is an organization that was designed to provide educational opportunity for all people. And I see heads nodding a little bit, and I'd like to know, how did you get the kids involved when you did the community research for a building that was going to predominantly have kids in it? My name is Bill Wyness. Thank you.
Thanks, Bill. I'm guessing your question's for Simon.
Okay. Well, I think as the photograph showed, when Chris was doing interviews, it wasn't just male members of the society, of the community, but it was actually a full spectrum of people, so from kids to elders. And in other projects that we have worked on, we've also had scenarios where we just did a school in Lutzkirch, it's in construction right now, where the community and particularly the kids were involved in, and we were sort of working with them to develop sketches for what they thought the school would be, and those sketches were then interpreted and brought back into the design of the school. So their imagery is sort of returned to them. So there is that whole process of engaging, and I think it's very important to engage the community as a whole rather than a sort of segment of the community. And I think when we were doing the Cougarac facility, again, almost finished, as we were saying, we're engaging with those interested in the building process right from the beginning all the way to the elders, sort of seniors group in the community. So it is important, I think, as you say, to address the full spectrum in your projects.
Thank you.
All right, does anyone else have questions?
This might for George, actually. What is the, George? Yeah. What is the single most frustrating thing you see happening over and over again every time you see a new building or a retrofit a building? What is something you would like to see different? Because I'm sure there's things you see besides crawl spaces that are 3 feet tall for midgets. What else?
That's a tough question, because I don't think we make the same mistakes over and over again. We make different mistakes each time. And from a mechanical engineering perspective, it is space that's the problem, and trying to get adequate space to make sure that we can maintain it for the long term. I think that's the biggest problem.
Okay, well, I'm going to take the opportunity to squeeze in a quick question, and I'll get to yours. It's for Joelle, Avalanche Kid. I was wondering if you could comment on the future of the Snow Castle in coming years.
I'd be happy to. So since last year, the Snow Castle's been working with the Office of the Fire Marshal, in compliance with some codes upon their recommendation, and so that's definitely a direction that's leading us, or that's directing us. Well, ironically, there is fire suppression and smoke detectors requested in the list, yeah, and with exits and. The list is very doable, and so, you know, that's a place that we're willing to go. And the festival has a very strong board of directors and tons of momentum in terms of its history. So it has a very hopeful future. Where it's going to go architecturally in terms of a space and its programming is you know, it's really up to us. It's supposed to be a community design, a community effort, and in a lot of ways it is, and I hope to see it like continue to be that and more, yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, it's important we continue the Snow Castle. All right.
Hi there. I'm sorry, terrible with names. The gentleman who was looking at the off-grid, housing. Have you looked into the? Are you aware of, or have you looked into the option of the airship design, which is basically a double glassed wall built on a long narrow house built into a south-facing berm? Is anybody doing that? Have you looked into that?
Thank you. Not aware of it on Shield Country, but maybe in the South Slave, you know, we have lots of rock around here. But yeah, blasting's expensive. Going into a rock structure would be interesting. I haven't really heard of anybody doing it per se, except for architects including, you know, the shield and the granite into part of their structures, like you see at St. Pat's. But as far as actually building an off-grid home into granite, I don't know what sure the R value is of granite. I mean, deep down it gets warm for sure, and you're maybe more talking about a geothermal kind of thing. But no, not that I'm aware of.
I had a question for Wayne. In terms of the R20 windows, is that at the center of the glazing, or is that the entire assembly, including the mullions and the glazing?
That's the entire assembly. And how we achieved that, I actually used two systems. I used a cowl wall system in conjunction with the aluminum thermally broken curtain wall system. And actually, it goes back to what Jay said there. We used that concept in the Canadian High Arctic Research Station, where we had a double envelope using a SIP on the exterior and an internal skin. So we created a sort of a solar-powered loop that then picked up solar gain from the south-facing, those large south-facing glass facades, and then circulated it through the double wall system of the glazing into the rear portion of the building, and then through cooling, regenerated that cycle. So the window system itself was better than the insulation of most walls in residential construction. And it's a system when I was doing my thesis in Arctic housing many moons ago, I went through Siberia, and what the Russians did, which was really interesting, is that they had two single pane pieces of glass with about a foot between them. And they used that for their herbs, for their winter harvest, because it's very bleak in the Siberian winter. And it created actually, even at 40 below with enough sun, it was actually above freezing in that interstitial space. So I hope everybody can hear. Thanks, Ben. And so that was a similar sort of concept with the Canadian High Arctic Research Station. And we've since employed it in other buildings, and it works like a charm.
All right, any more questions?
So a question for Warren here. Just on the, you mentioned you had 0.4 allowance for settlement, I guess. Is that because just, I guess, with your winter snow melt, and then you just grade it all, or how do you address it in the summer, I guess? I'm kind of curious.
Well, that number was arrived at through a bit of trial and error, and also through the scientific method. So precursors to ITH were development of the access to source 177 on the Tuck side. So it was kind of like a test road per se, where a lot of the techniques that were employed in the actual highway itself were utilized and proven out before the big investment in the overall highway. So as I think I might be off on the numbers a little bit, but say for example, they built that road with about a 0.9 meter embankment, and then they found that it sort of settled about 0.2 the next summer. And so the reason why it settled is you're placing this material in the winter when it's frozen, and then when it hits the warmer ambient air temperatures in the summer, there's of course some melt. And so kind of the rule of thumb was it generally fell by about 0.4. So we wanted to kind of approximate where we wanted the design grade to be with what we've kind of figured the amount of settlement would be once it hit the warmer summer temperatures. There's another question there.
Thanks very much. A question about the influence of the changed solar gain on the character of the embankment in the Tuck Road and how that changes the deep permafrost degradation because of more solar gain on the gravel road as opposed to being naturally protected by foliage. Have you made any comment or observations about that? And in long-term testing for permafrost at depth, say down 2 to 3 meters or more, have you had any plans to test for the effect of increased solar gain on the granular surface of the embankment and on the roadway? Thank you.
Before I came here, I skimmed through the 300-page design brief report and tried to soak up as much of it as I can. And in terms of solar gain, I mean, the roadway itself is going to be a gravel finished surface, so it's not going to have blacktop on it, which would introduce a lot more solar gain into the embankment itself. The material itself is generally not dark either, so the solar gain by that is not so much either. But for the most part, the intent behind the embankment thickness itself was to minimize the influence of the permafrost underneath the embankment itself. And as for long-term monitoring, I know there's a network of thermistors that are put in, not only in bridge locations or culvert locations, but also in discrete areas where the most sensitive terrain was passed. So there's research and development projects that alternative drainage systems were put in, and I'm sure, you know, moving forward, there was an awful lot of data that was gathered that's going to be investigated by PhD students and the consulting community and the government on and on. So, I mean, it was a groundbreaking project. No one, to my knowledge, has ever attempted to build a highway of this nature in that kind of terrain. And I think it's a testament to the people of the region and what they were able to accomplish in getting that investment from the Government of Canada. And to go back to the question about, you know, how do these projects affect kids, well, I think the kids of the area are going to be the ones that benefit the most. And I watched a story on CBC last night. I talked to one of the carvers there who, when he grew up, he thought he was never going to get out of Tuck. And now these kids that are... They're not going to experience that. They're going to have a link to the outside world, and so they're going to grow up with their community and their culture, but they're also going to grow up knowing that they can get out and see the world and maybe bring some of that back to their community.
Thank you so much, everybody, for coming tonight. Thank you, Richard. Before you go, I'm going to use this opportunity to promote our next event, which is Changing Climate, Changing Buildings. So this is happening 24th of November The tickets are, the early bird ticket price is $65. Our lead presenter is Marie-France Sandal from White Architecture in Stockholm. And the project that she's going to present is absolutely interesting and phenomenal.
What's going on up here?
Presentation.
For what?
Architect.
Oh, architect.